Good evening, and thank you for joining us here for our Lung Learning Health Professional webinar series. My name is Amanda Curran, and I'm the respiratory care nurse here at Lung Foundation Australia. It is my actual pleasure to be hosting for you tonight, as I have a passionate interest in immunisation, not only in my current role here at Lung Foundation Australia, but also through my previous roles in general practice and as an immunisation coordinator. So I'm genuinely grateful for tonight's expert speaker. Through this virtual meeting place tonight, we are gathering together from all parts of Australia, and I would like to take the time to acknowledge and pay my respects to the traditional owners of country, acknowledging their enduring connection to land, sea, and community, and our elders past, present, and emerging. For myself here in Brisbane this evening, I stand on the lands of the Yagara and Turrbal peoples. I do this in the spirit of reconciliation, acknowledging that our First Nations peoples are substantially overrepresented in lung diseases and lung cancer. Tonight's session for you will focus on vaccine-preventable illness in patients with chronic lung disease, the right vaccine for the right patient. Before I introduce our speaker for tonight, I will just briefly run through some housekeeping. Firstly, I will let you know that this session will be recorded and available for viewing on demand immediately after this session through the On24 platform and for 3 months afterwards. You will automatically receive an email with details to access this recording if you registered for the event, or you can register to get instant access to the on-demand version at any time after the session. After 3 months, this recording will be hosted at Lung Foundation Australia's YouTube channel and our website. Tonight, if you're having any technical difficulties, you can try using the information widget in order to troubleshoot the problems, as we cannot guarantee any technical questions will be answered if you submit them through the Q&A box. This webcast platform is possibly different than others that you've been used to before. You will see there are a number of interactive features on this webinar console, which we encourage you to make use of throughout tonight's webcast. Please access the group chat feature throughout the presentation to connect with your colleagues, the resource hub to access a number of links and documents and resources. So if you look to the right of the presentation slides, there'll be a resource hub there for you to download live the resources that have been kindly made available by our presenter this evening. The feature is available throughout the webinar by submitting your questions through that Q&A box. So we highly encourage you and feel welcome as we go through tonight's presentation. And I will make a note of your questions and direct it to our speaker during our Q&A segment, which will be conducted at the end of tonight's presentation. We would like you to complete the evaluation at the end of the webinar, as this will enable your certificate of attendance to be created automatically and then emailed to you to use for your documentation for your continuing professional development. So without further ado, I'm delighted to introduce our expert speaker for tonight. Professor Kristine Macartney is the Director of the National Centre for Immunisation Research and Surveillance, commonly known in our primary healthcare world as NCIRS. She's a paediatric infectious disease consultant at the Children's Hospital at Westmead and a professor in the Faculty of Medicine and Health at University of Sydney. Her research interests include all aspects of vaccine-preventable disease, particularly policy development, vaccine safety, and prevention of viral diseases. Kristine acts regularly as an expert consultant to the World Health Organization and is a member of peak advisory committees in Australia. She also leads the Australian National AusVax Safety and Paediatric Active Enhanced Disease Surveillance, commonly we know that as PEDS networks, and is the founding chair of the Australian Regional Immunisation Alliance, ARIA, which is working with countries and partners in the Indo-Pacific region. Thank you, Kristine, for taking the time to speak with us tonight above your amazingly busy schedule, and I'll now hand over to you for your presentation.
Oh, thank you so much, Amanda, and particularly for that very warm welcome, and hello to everyone this evening. Thank you for taking the time out to join. I would like to also, acknowledge all those with chronic lung disease and all of you who care for people and help prevent chronic lung disease. And I would also acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which I'm speaking to you from, so the Darug people of the Great Eora Nation. I'm sitting out here in Western Sydney and, you know, one of my favourite parts of the world. But I definitely send my respects to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people across the whole of Australia and, you know, acknowledge their elders past, present and emerging. So I think, you know, look, when it comes to lung health, there are a number of infectious diseases for which vaccines exist that we have at our disposal and, you know, which I think we've had enormous success in over many decades, actually. And I can't possibly cover them all. I put down some, you know, aspects of vaccine-preventable disease world that I wouldn't cover, such as whooping cough and, of course, things like diphtheria, for which we know still exists in the world and would roar back if we were to drop vaccination at all. But tonight I thought I'd focus mainly on an update on some COVID-19 vaccine data, on pneumococcal vaccine for the prevention of pneumococcal pneumonia and invasive pneumococcal disease, and, of course, on influenza vaccine, not quite in that order. And I gather the audience is fairly diverse, you know, people who are in primary care or, you know, are caring for patients with lung disease from different aspects of practice. So I thought I'd, you know, try to be broad in respect of talking about vaccination strategies more generally, you know, try to focus in on where we have under vaccination, talk about First Nations people and, you know, try to walk in through in a bit of detail these three topic areas. So just let's talk about COVID-19 vaccines. What have you, you know, how could you not have heard about these incredible vaccines? You know, it's, I think, close to a year now since the first vaccines were in clinical trials, and it's quite remarkable that we have about 15 vaccines now in use across the world. And of course, around 8 vaccines being used quite commonly in many countries of the world. We, of course, are using 2 vaccines in Australia, but we have, you know, some countries that are using 3 or 4 different types. So when we think about the disease of coronavirus disease itself, of course, it has and can have a profound impact on the lungs. I'm sure I don't need to explain this to the audience here. And I've just snipped a few, you know, data points out of a couple of studies here that popped up for me about the considerable proportion of patients who, having had COVID-19, still have, you know, lung function abnormalities at 6 months, you know, after their acute illness. And this does appear to correlate with the severity of the acute illness, but is not only limited to severe disease in the acute phase, with certainly a need for ongoing studies in this group. But I think, you know, sadly, one of the many effects of the pandemic is that we will see, you know, long-term lung health being a real issue that, you know, we do need to plan for in respect of the many millions of patients worldwide now who have, you know, thankfully recovered from COVID-19, but are likely to have chronic illness. So in that context, of course, to prevent COVID itself, we are rolling out vaccines here and in Australia, and we're rolling them out across the globe. And I don't have time to talk to you about global vaccine coverage, but you would know that there are now more than 2 billion doses of COVID-19 vaccine that have been administered across the globe. In Australia, where we're nudging above, I think that the number for today will be above the 6 million mark of vaccine doses given. Of course, it is a 2-dose vaccine schedule, and, you know, rolling out across the country in different sorts of ways. So without going into this, what I thought I would talk to you a little bit about is how do these vaccines protect us? And the reason I'm pulling this together is we've presented this data to a number of audiences in the past week. And I thought, you know, I haven't focused a lot on safety here. I'm happy to take questions about that. But I thought focusing in on real-world effectiveness, you know, might particularly make you think of your roles and spark some questions from you tonight. So, of course, we're using Pfizer, which is an mRNA vaccine. This encodes the viral spike protein of SARS-CoV-2, and the mRNA is coded in lipid nanoparticles, and then when it's introduced to our cells through injection, it works, our cellular machinery turns that mRNA into spike protein. The AstraZeneca vaccine is also what we call a genetic vaccine, but the genetic code for the spike protein is carried into the cells as part of an adenovirus vector or carrier. And so that carries in what is actually the DNA for the spike protein, which again is then transcribed into mRNA, and then that makes the spike protein. So, we are expecting other vaccines to come down the track, but these are two that have been used the most across the world. In fact, AstraZeneca has the most global use of any vaccine. Pfizer, I think one of the Chinese vaccines follows shortly thereafter in terms of doses administered, and Pfizer is not far behind. So just I'm going to show you some effectiveness data. Now, in vaccine clinical studies, we tend to talk about efficacy data being that obtained from randomised controlled clinical trials under strict ideal conditions, usually with quite limited populations enrolled. So, of course, you have to be reasonably well to get into a clinical trial. It would be limited in age, may not have a lot of people with underlying medical conditions. I am pleased to say that a number of the, in fact, many of the vaccine trials for different COVID-19 vaccines did enroll patients with chronic conditions, including people with chronic lung disease, diabetes, heart disease. But of course, they enrolled a lot of very well people also. So what we want to look at then is the effectiveness studies. And these are real world studies obtained post-licensure in general populations, everybody who's been vaccinated. And they really do better reflect what we can expect of vaccine protection. They, of course, come with some caveats that are always limitations on who you study and how you study them. But as you can see, we now have a lot of studies from the UK, Israel, Qatar, Sweden, the US, Denmark and Finland. So a huge amount of value from being able to observe how the vaccines are performing, and healthcare worker studies in the US and UK, and studies in older age groups in the UK and Spain. And to be honest, there's one of these studies coming out almost every week or two a week at the moment. So there's a lot to keep up with. The take-home message is good. COVID-19 vaccines reduce the likelihood of severe disease. They reduce the likelihood of any disease with symptoms. They reduce the likelihood of asymptomatic infection, and they reduce the likelihood that even if you are infected, you transmit to another person. So this is even in the absence of what we call herd immunity, where you want a whole lot of people vaccinated to suppress the spread of the virus in the community. Just person-to-person transmission is already being reduced at a small group level, which is excellent. Okay, so the other important thing to note, which you're also aware of, is the SARS-CoV-2 variants. And these are new variants of concern. So since we had the original Wuhan strain, there's been now the Alpha variant, which originated in the UK, B117, they all had different names. The Beta variant, which originated in South Africa. The Gamma variant, which originated in Brazil. And a new variant, Delta, and also actually another variant, Kappa, which originated in India. But if you look at this map, it's pretty obvious that these variant strains are really replacing, or if not, coming level pegging with the original strain. So we really are now in a situation of looking at effectiveness against variants as well as against the original strain for which the vaccines were developed. Plenty to think about. So I'm going to show you a few forest plots now, and I'm sure you're familiar with this, but just along the bottom, we're talking here about vaccine effectiveness being zero. The midpoint dot in the middle is the estimate of vaccine effectiveness with the 95% confidence on intervals on either side. And essentially, you can see here, if you look at any SARS-CoV-2 infection, and we're dealing here with AstraZeneca vaccine in either all adults or older adults. And what's important to note is many of these studies are post-dose one. In fact, I think every single one of them, if I get really close to the slide, is post-dose one. And the outcome measures here are a little different. They vary from, hospitalisation, symptomatic infection, death, you can see in purple, or asymptomatic infection in the yellow. But essentially, the news is good even after one vaccine dose. Remember, for AstraZeneca, most of these studies were in settings, and we also have a setting where we give the second dose 12 weeks later rather than, 3 or 4 weeks later. So that's why most of the studies aren't yet post-dose two. But excellent one-dose effectiveness and higher almost than even expected from some of the clinical trial data, with things like 80%, 84%, 88% against COVID-19 requiring hospitalisation. Now, there are many studies for Pfizer, and this is probably a little hard to see. It certainly is for me. But again, all adults, older adults, and, healthcare workers here on the left, different types of outcome measures, infection, where you kind of, anybody who gets a test basically is usually included in this study design. Symptomatic infection is a carve-out, severe disease, hospitalisation. And some of these studies are post-dose one, those that tend to have the more modest effectiveness. And then you see this really excellent tight clustering of high effectiveness post-dose two against all of these outcome measures. So, these vaccines stop you from getting infected even if you're, asymptomatic from that infection. They stop asymptomatic infection. Really good news. This is against the variants now. So I've talked to you about the fact that there are variants. What do those variants mean for us? Well, firstly, they're generally more transmissible. So somewhere between, 40 to 60% more transmissible, even potentially higher for some of the variants. They tend to need a higher, there are lower neutralising antibody titers derived in vaccinated people. So the immunogenicity of the vaccine is not as great. But what about the effectiveness? Because we don't really know exactly what level antibody you need. So what about effectiveness? Well, it's still looking pretty good. And the studies here are with both the UK variant for AstraZeneca post-dose one and also with the Delta variant, which is the new Indian variant. In the UK, this study was done post-dose one. And you can see with dose one, sorry, so I'm going here for if you take the study with the original UK variant, going from 51% here to 66%, post dose two, or going with the Delta variant, the Indian variant, from 32% post dose one up to almost 60% post dose two. So even though these variants are somewhat more troubling, still a good response post dose two. And with Pfizer, again, a number of additional studies against the variants. So those two variants here are mainly the UK strain, but also the South African strain, which has been quite challenging for some vaccines. But in Qatar, again, here we can see that there is still protection if you do have this South African vaccine. It is not as good as for some of the other strains, but definitely really looking much stronger after the second dose. So, the key here, I think, is for the variants is being sure to be, get your patients to come back and have that second dose. Don't worry too much about the spacing at this stage because we don't have circulating virus. If anything, the general rule of vaccinology is if the second dose is spaced out a little more, you can tend to get slightly higher immunogenicity because you lay down more immune memory after your first dose and it tends to do you well. Of course, that comes at a cost. If you've got virus circulating around, you might get infected post-dose one, but we don't have that here. So, don't be too worried when you hear the news that not everybody's got their second dose yet. We want that on board, but we also want a lot of people to get their first dose. Okay, so, again, really strong evidence here that effectiveness increases with time following dose one. It takes about 2 to 3 weeks before it kicks in. Effectiveness post dose two does increase with the dosing interval. I haven't shown you that in a lot of detail. I haven't put in the household transmission study, but there is about 50% protection against transmitting to someone in your own household. So what that means is if you went to work, you got you know, you were vaccinated, you had your two doses, you happened to, you know, be at work or wherever you were, encounter someone with the infection. If you got infected, even if you didn't know you were infected, your chance of passing the virus on to someone in your household is cut in half compared with what it would have been before, which is excellent news. It's not zero, but these vaccines are performing very well, even against transmission. So there is generally higher effectiveness against, you know, severe disease compared with symptomatic infection, compared with any detection. Against severe disease in dose two recipients, protection is extremely high, which is exactly what we wanted. There is some lower effectiveness for variants of concern, but this improves post dose two. Do we need lots more data? Of course we do. This is a brand new virus, and we know this virus is going to be with us in the world to come. So I can't stress this enough. Don't be of the view that this virus is ever going to be eliminated. This is a new virus that is with us for the rest of our lives. I strongly believe that, and I think most of, you know, professionals, you know, who are close to this do. We've managed to shut it out through extreme, you know, actions and public health measures, but we need as many of the population to be vaccinated as possible. We will all meet this virus. Hopefully we'll meet it and we won't even know, because if we do get infected, it'll be either asymptomatic or just a mild illness. But we need to make sure that as many people are vaccinated as possible, because otherwise we're just, you know, the ones who aren't vaccinated are going to be the sitting ducks. And this is really all about taking up vaccines for as much of the population over time. Now, we know we won't be vaccinating children, at least not right away, certainly not young children, and they can be infected. Again, we'll still see the virus circulate, you know, in the world and in this country once we start to let it in a bit more. But of course, we won't eliminate it. So we probably will need boosters. I haven't talked to you about those. We need more, you know, post dose two studies for some of the viral vector vaccines like AstraZeneca with the longer gap. And we also need some more information on mixed schedules and booster schedules, duration of protection. I haven't put them in, but there are, you know, the companies are doing booster studies now 6 to 8 months down the track, and some of them have tweaked the vaccines, particularly against the South African variant that I mentioned, the beta variant, to use the mRNA for that variant, or at least partly use mRNA for that variant in their booster doses. So we should get the results of those booster studies in coming months. Okay, let's switch viruses and talk about the flu. Because this, of course, is a very big respiratory pathogen. It has been with us for centuries, of course, unlike SARS-CoV-2, just with us for a little over a year. And we have a lot of vaccines in our armamentarium. But, of course, this is a seasonal virus. SARS-CoV-2 may well settle into a seasonal pattern over time once, you know, it kind of moves across the world. But look what it does. It, you know, it's here it is in respect of 2009. That was the pandemic for influenza. And here it is in 2017. So you're going to say, why wasn't that called a pandemic, given it looked like about three times greater than 2009? Well, partly it's because we just have much better testing and detection for influenza. We tend to use a lot of PCR tests now in primary care and many other settings. So 2017 was a whopper year. It was a terrible year for deaths, particularly in older people, with an H3N2 predominance. But this was also 2019, another very large year. And then what happened in 2020? Well, we quarantined influenza out of the country. We really think it was that quarantine as well as early social distancing that just meant we didn't have a flu season. What's happened this year? Well, so far we seem to be quarantining influenza out of Australia still. And there's a tiny little trickle of cases, but it's you know, it's possible we won't see a significant influenza season, but just like COVID can escape quarantine, flu can escape quarantine too. And we could well see a blip up in flu. So, you know, again, we need to be thinking about vaccine very actively this year, because it's easy and it's going to give us that protection on board. I predict, and I could be wrong, it's only a crystal ball, of course, but I predict we will have some rather terrible flu seasons coming up in future years, because We haven't had the usual sort of immune boosting, even on top of vaccination, that we would have had from moderate flu seasons last year, for example. So what's coverage like? And what's coverage like in people with comorbidities? It's okay, but it's not great. So here's some data from hospitalised individuals in the FluCan Sentinel Network, which has about 20 hospitals across the country. And the reason we can get data from there for people with comorbidities is because, you know, it's active surveillance and it's recorded in the chart. We don't have national, you know, uniform data on what flu vaccination is like in people with different comorbidities. And this is a real gap. But we do have a solution coming up, which I can talk to you about. So if you take the influenza test negative people, we can't take the test positive because, of course, you would expect that they would, you know, have a lower uptake because they've actually been infected. So you take the test negative people and you see that in 65 plus, only about 50%, you know, are actually covered. So they may be having a propensity to lower uptake here. You know, on the register and in other surveys, we see more like 60 to 70% in your regular 65 plus years. But I think over here with comorbidities, it's encouraging that we have a slightly higher uptake. But on the flip side, that's still not great. This is a vaccine which is completely free for this age group and particularly recommended for those with comorbidities. So look at our middle-aged adults here. They have a risk factor for influenza, but only less than half of them are vaccinated. So we have some room to go there. This now is data from the Australian Immunisation Register. And in the register, we have the ability to look at Indigenous status compared with, you know, non-Indigenous Australians. As I mentioned, you know, that's a register, if you're familiar with primary care, you will have, you know, you'll have your desktop primary care software linked to the register transmitting vaccines. I certainly hope you do because it's now mandatory to report to the AIR for both COVID and for flu vaccines. And it's about to come on in July for all NIP vaccines to be mandatory to report to the AIR. So no matter where you're giving a vaccine, whether it's a hospital, a clinic, you know, a workforce program, you know, you need to be saying, we all need to be saying, does this clinic transmit data to the AIR? Am I sure that the vaccine that I'm giving is going to be on someone's personal record on their MyGov account so that they can know that they've received this vaccine? So anyway, looking at this data, I think the good news is here in the over 65s, we can see what looks like more like 3/4 of the population vaccinated. And this is in Indigenous Australians. So what I haven't got here is non-Indigenous Australians, and it's a few percentage points lower. But you can see high uptake, including in 2020, which, you know, there was a lot of messaging around flu uptake. I think, unfortunately, this year, and I haven't got the data to show you, but I think we're not doing as well in 2021. We don't have as many vaccines going into arms at the present time. It's still early days, but we need a big shout out for 2021. So about half of our Aboriginal Torres Strait Islander population, 50 to 65 years covered. Is flu vaccine free for everybody in this age group? Absolutely, it is. And so, you know, really we could be doing a much better job of getting, you know, getting our Aboriginal communities vaccinated. And there's a lot of resources to support this that I'll show you shortly. Does the vaccine work? You know, people say, oh, I had the flu vaccine and then I got the flu. Well, firstly, we all know that there's a lot of other respiratory viruses that can mimic the flu, and people sometimes think that rhinovirus, RSV, parainfluenza virus, the whole host of other viruses that we can test for on a panel of 20 or so, that they cause the flu. But in fact, you know, they don't. So this is looking at influenza test positive people and seeing with test negative people and comparing their vaccination status. And you can see that, you know, across the board, if you look at all patients in 2019, the vaccine was about 45% protective against hospitalisation. So this is data against hospitalisation, which is really good that if you, you know, have a vaccine, it's you've got a 50-50 chance that it'll keep you out of hospital if you get the flu, which is excellent. The vaccines tend to perform quite a lot better against this H1N1, which is one of the subgroups of flu A. And it's just because of egg adaptations and other things, the vaccines tend to always come out with a higher effectiveness and efficacy against flu A, particularly H1N1, but not so much against AH3N2, which tends to, when you adapt the vaccine strain in growth, particularly in eggs and for various other reasons, effectiveness against this particular strain is not as great. Partly this is also because this is the strain that infects people at extremes of age and particularly the elderly. Flu B, right on target here, risk factors. So people might say, well, I've got a risk factor. You know, I'm older or whatever, the vaccine doesn't work in me. Well, it does work. It works just as well as in people without risk factors. Here we have a slightly lower point estimate in the elderly, but in children, again, the vaccine worked well. This elderly estimate tends to be when we have big H3N2 years. The vaccine did appear to work last year as well in 2020, but there were such low numbers that we couldn't be very precise about that. So we need to improve flu vaccine coverage data in those with comorbidities, and I'm sure we need to improve uptake as well. We have the ability soon to link the Australian Immunisation Register with some other health data sets that will let us understand who has comorbidities and who's getting vaccines, and that should allow us come through to 2022 to get better estimates in people with underlying health conditions and hopefully feed that back to the program to make sure that we're getting vaccines to people who need them the most. Okay, so just quickly now, we're on to some of the resources. This is the data about the influenza strains included in this year's Southern Hemisphere seasonal flu vaccine. We have a new cell-based influenza vaccine this year, and it has slightly different strains. Now, the reason that this is all contained within an ATAGI statement, this information, which the link is here for you. So if you just Google ATAGI, A-T-A-G-I, 2021 influenza statement, you'll see this come up. And the cell-based vaccine, I'll tell you a little bit about. Firstly, we know vaccination is recommended for everybody 6 months of age. We use exclusively quadrivalent influenza vaccines in Australia. We have an adjuvanted vaccine in the over 65s. It's the preferred vaccine. It's not the only vaccine you can give. You can give the other vaccines to over 65 if you don't have the adjuvanted vaccine handy. But it is the preferred vaccine because it has a little bit of an edge in effectiveness, efficacy, we think, over the non-adjuvanted vaccines. It's a standard dose for everybody, no half doses for children. And, of course, the minimum interval between flu and COVID-19 vaccine, it was 14 days, you might have heard that, but in the last 2 weeks we've changed that to 7 days. And, in fact, it can be even less than 7 days. So the principle here is we were being precautionary. We didn't have data on co-administration or same-day administration. But again, that is possible if you're having real issues in delivering the vaccines. It's possible to have them both on the same day. But certainly we're trying to say if you've had one vaccine and you're fine after it, you don't have any fever anymore, which of course you can get after your COVID-19 vaccine. We know you can have fever, myalgia, chills in the first 1 to 2 days, but they go away. If you're over that, you can have your flu vaccine. Don't worry too much about how many days afterwards it is. I mentioned the cell-based influenza vaccine. So this is where the actual seed viruses that are taken of the four different influenza strains, instead of growing them in embryonated eggs, actually eggs where the virus is growing, they're now being grown for this vaccine in immortalized cell lines in the laboratory. And this was done to try to see less genetic adaptations in the virus itself. Hopefully growing them in the cells means that they're not quite as changed as they would be from growing in the eggs, and that they then continue to match the circulating strains more and generate a better, tighter, fit immune response. Now, it may have a little bit of an edge, flu cell vax, but some other studies suggest it doesn't. So it's not being preferentially recommended over other vaccines at this stage. It certainly appears to be as safe as other vaccines. It is registered from 9 years of age, but it's also not yet free under the National Immunisation Program. You have to pay for this vaccine So, you know, it's out there, it's available for purchase, but it's not on the NIP. Okay, and we talked about mandatory reporting to the air. Here's a complicated table, I won't go into it, but the key take-home practice points for flu vaccine are check the age of the patient. Check if they've had a vaccine already this year, of course. You want to make sure that they haven't had that, and particularly if their memory is not serving them well, you want to check the AIR. You know, ask them when they've had their recent vaccines. Of course, go through the screening checklist. There's an excellent screening checklist available as a tool, and you should, you know, hopefully use that as part of your routine practice if you're actually giving vaccines. Okay, so I think we've already talked about this largely. These are the actual NIP funded groups. So all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, young children now for the last couple of years, any stage of pregnancy. We know that vaccination protects the unborn infant as well because they're not eligible to have their vaccine until 6 months of age. People over 65 and people with medical conditions. When's the best time to get it? Look, you know, now if you haven't had it. Optimal protection about, you know, within the first 3 to 4 months. It doesn't drop off a cliff though. So, you know, you can never really time when the flu season's coming, usually around April to May, but don't stop offering it, particularly for pregnant women. We only recommend a second dose of influenza vaccine in the same year if you're a young child having it for the first time. So a lot of people ask about second doses. It seemed to be a thing for a while, but the only other context is if you're getting your first round of vaccinations after you've had a stem cell or solid organ transplant. And sometimes if you're going overseas, which doesn't happen much these days, you might want to get another dose. I think we've talked about COVID-19 vaccines. And what I would like to do is highlight this particular website, AusVac Safety. If you haven't seen it, please jump on, just ausvacsafety.org.au. And it is the site that we run. I'm showing you here the influenza data for 2021 as of the 10th of June. So that was last week, and we'll upload it again, I think probably tomorrow. But we generally get about 300,000, 400,000 people who respond to an SMS survey on how they went after the vaccine, if they had any adverse events. So it's a really active vaccine safety tracking mechanism. You might want to know how many people with COVID vaccine we've been surveying so far. It's over 1 million people. So if you jump on here and you click into the COVID vaccine site, you'll see what everybody reports, dose one Pfizer, dose two Pfizer, dose one Astra, dose two Astra, by Aboriginal status. And pretty soon we're going to put that up by chronic medical conditions too. The good news is for your patients with lung disease is that we're not seeing any significantly different safety profile in patients with lung disease or other chronic medical conditions for the COVID-19 vaccines. And the same goes for influenza vaccine, actually. But the COVID-19 data is over 1 million patients included in the survey so far. Huge amount of data on safety being actively monitored. Okay, can someone with an egg allergy get flu vaccines? Yes. Can someone with latex allergy get flu vaccines? Yes. Are there lots of other questions that people ask about flu vaccines? Yes. And where can you find them? Right here. We've got lots of fact sheets. These contain a lot of detailed answers to really specific questions that lots of people actually have. So please do use these. And if there's a question that's not here and you want it to be here, just drop us an email. And we'd love to add some more information. There's lots of state and territory resources, as well as our own national centre resources. And there's a particularly great hub for parents of children who, not just for flu vaccine, but for regular vaccines as well, called Sharing Knowledge About Immunisation. There's a whole suite of resources here. So if your next door neighbour's saying, oh, you know, I'm not sure about vaccines, and you're saying, well, you know, I know about them, but look, why don't you have a look at this website? It's got parents, it's got an e-learning module for providers, and it's got a provider website. And it's particularly good at helping provide resources about how to talk to parents. And we've got a new flu module coming here to patients who have questions and are unsure about vaccines. Okay, we've only got about maybe 5 more minutes, so... for those of you who are getting hungry, I'll just take you through the pneumococcal vaccination schedule changes. So I'm a virus person myself. You know, I really like bacteria, but pneumococci are pretty challenging. So firstly, you know, what I would suggest is that if I'm going to confuse you with this talk, do be sure, if you're interested in this space, to jump onto the Australian Immunisation Handbook. I think it's got a quick link now, apparently. You just write Australian Immunisation Handbook, you'll go right there. I tend to go in through the Vaccine Preventable Diseases tab, because you can right away then go to the pneumococcal chapter. It's kind of layered in a way that tells you the schedule, and it links you to other things. You can go into the vaccine section, but the actual diseases chapter is a little bit easier. You can go into the special risk groups, but it'll tend to link you back to some of the particular disease areas. But huge amount of resources here, including, you know, lots of visuals and graphics for your practice if you like those. Let's just remember that we've got two types of pneumococcal vaccine. So in the beginning, at the beginning of time, there was just the sugar coating of each different strain. So there are about 100 different serotypes or serogroups of pneumococcus. And this particular vaccine was developed many decades ago with the sugar moiety of the outside of the bacteria from 23 different serotypes. So we call it 23 valent. But just the sugar alone is less immunogenic and doesn't create as much immune memory, has less impact on nasal carriage of the bacteria, and this hasn't been a vaccine that's been used typically in young children. So to immunise young children, these conjugate protein conjugated to a polysaccharide, the sugar, vaccines have been developed. And they were first started to be used in the late 1990s and you know, around 2000 in Australia. We started off with a 7-valent type, moving to a 13-valent type. There's also been a 10-valent vaccine that has had a Hib conjugate carrier, protein carrier, but that hasn't been widely used in Australia. And there are now 15-valent and 20-valent vaccines coming. So you can, people say, well, why would I want the 13 when I can get the 23? They are different vaccines. So the conjugate vaccines are more immunogenic, including in infants. They give you better immune memory and can reduce nasal carriage, but of course they do have fewer serotypes. We've been using the 13-valent since about 2011, and that's been an excellent vaccine, and it made a big impact. So really complicated slide here. I'll just refer you to the study, but essentially a big impact not only in the children that we've been vaccinating, with our initial schedule, which was 2, 4, 6 months of pneumococcal conjugate vaccine, 7-valent and then initially 13-valent, but also in older age groups. So as you can see here, there's a trend line for the pneumococcal types covered by the vaccine declining in age groups that weren't really, you know, getting or certainly didn't have high uptake of the vaccine. But we have seen, you know, non-7-valent types and then non-13-valent types. So we've had to move and change the schedule. Indeed, in children, young children here, there was also a great impact on meningitis. So you can see the reduction in the bars of the different types of meningitis. I don't have the key for you here, but vaccine types and non-vaccine types. But even though we'd changed the schedule and introduced 13-valent, we were still having this little peak in meningitis cases in the second year of life in children. So the bottom, I hope my cursor is working here. I'm jiggling it around if you can see it. But in the bottom graph, right in the middle, the grey bars, still a peak of meningitis. So we changed the schedule. And instead of being 3+0, 2, 4, 6, we changed it to 2, 4 and putting the third dose out to 12 months of age to act more like a booster. The other thing, though, about pneumococcus is it really does target people with chronic medical conditions. So without going into detail here, you can see a 22-fold increased risk in those with risk factors here, or an 85-fold increased risk with those with risk factors in different periods of the program. So we've got more doses for people with risk factors, and this includes your population of people with chronic lung disease. So children with adults and adults with conditions that increase their risk of pneumococcal disease include Aboriginal Torres Strait Islander people in certain states and territories because they still have higher rates, those over 50 years, and all non-Indigenous people over 70 years. Plus, there's a list of underlying medical conditions that have been shown through extremely rigorous analysis of all available literature across the world to be associated with an increased rate of pneumococcal disease. It does vary slightly for young children compared with old children. And I won't go into all of this, but your patients with chronic respiratory disease are here in the centre of this list. So this is all about knowing who these patients are and giving them the extra doses that they're recommended. For the sake of time, I won't go into all of this in detail, but we're now using a universal childhood schedule that is one dose at 2 months, one dose at 4 months, and then the booster dose, or the third dose, is now at 12 months of age. This is for most children in Australia. But if you have a child who has a risk condition, including chronic lung disease, or they're Aboriginal living in one of these four states, they need four doses, not three doses. And the dose that they get is inserted into the middle. So they still have that dose at 6 months, and they get followed up with the polysaccharide vaccine. If you have an older child, adolescent or adult with a risk condition, we now want them to get first up, if they're newly diagnosed or if they haven't been vaccinated before, and a dose of 13-valent, you know, Prevnar conjugate vaccine. So they will have, you know, they have had their schedule as a child, and then they'll flip into having an additional dose and then two more doses of Pneumovax. The number of doses, of course, will depend on when they're diagnosed with their chronic condition and what number of doses they've already received before. So you can see here how this works out. You need to know the age, you need to know what doses they've had before. Do they have a medical condition, yes or no? And then you plan out a schedule for them. Aboriginal Torres Strait Islander people, again, you want to get that Prevnar 13 dose in at age 50 and follow up with two doses of the polysaccharide vaccine. And for non-Indigenous adults with a risk condition, the schedule changed so that it's now starting at 70 years with a dose of the conjugate vaccine, not Prevnar 23 that we were, Pneumovax 23 that we were using before at 65 years of age. So this is quite a significant change for older people. And this happened midway through last year in the middle of a pandemic. So I'm sure this is something that's still being worked through and really needs to continue to be messaged about. But it's really important that we do know that this vaccine acts very well. There are still, there are people with risk conditions, they're older, and, you know, those two things go together and they are going to benefit more from 13-valent. So just for the sake of time, I will skip through some of this. There's a number of resources, a number of key messages about the program that I think I've already covered, and you'll have there in the slides. There is a catch-up calculator on the immunisation website, and under the handbook it's being expanded. There is a pneumo-smart tool that's been developed by the immunisation specialist group. So a really whiz-through talk, and I know some of the pneumococcal recommendations in particular are quite complicated, but I think it does hopefully allow you to have those anchoring principles about knowing who your patient is, screen what they've had, understand their age and what the right schedule is for them, the right vaccine and the right patient. I love that title. Really thinking about how your patients with chronic lung disease can be linked into a good primary care immunisation service or getting it in your specialist clinic, using the resources, doing the history checks. I think obviously culturally appropriate services for our First Nations people who generally have an excellent track record of doing well with vaccines, but there can be some timeliness issues. And of course, working together across the disciplines. I would just like to acknowledge some of those who've helped me from my team at the National Centre with slides, and thank you all for your attention. Oops, there we go.
Thank you so much, Professor Macartney, for that comprehensive, informative presentation, and particularly for the supportive resources. We have had a couple of participants just ask whether or not you'd be willing to share your slides of the presentation for tonight for us to have the capacity to attach it to the wrap-up email and email to all the registered participants for this evening.
Oh, yeah, look, that's absolutely... my pleasure to do that. Sorry, I might be clicking on different things here. I'm not sure on the platform, but no, very happy to send a PDF of the slides to the group.
Amazing. Thank you. We're exceptionally grateful, and like for all the participants that are live this evening, we will attach the presentation slides to the wrap-up email, which will be sent out to all the attendees. So I'm just going to have a little look at some of the questions that have come in, Professor Macartney, if that's okay.
Call me Kristine Amanda, or I'm going to feel about 110, please.
All right, let's make you 21. Thank you, Kristine. Okay. So a really good question came through, and it's actually a COVID-related question. It's around if somebody has received the AstraZeneca vaccine, dose one and dose two, a completed schedule, for the very first time they've ever received the COVID vaccine. If it's indicated later down the track that we realise that a booster is required, will we need to continue with an AstraZeneca vaccine, or do you imagine that there will eventually be some interchangeability between the available COVID vaccines to complete either schedules or boosters?
Yeah, I think there will be interchangeability. I mean, we see interchangeability with other vaccines, you know, commonly different types that can be used in an interchangeable way. And, you know, at the moment, we know that certainly Moderna, Pfizer, they're working actively on a booster program. I understand AstraZeneca is. I haven't seen the detailed presentation of that. But there are now some studies starting to emerge on mixed schedules. We're not routinely recommending that. You know, these are tiny studies with limited data, whereas, of course, we have the big effectiveness and efficacy data on, you know, those who've had, you know, the same two doses of the vaccine. So we're not recommending that you switch between dose one and dose two. But certainly once you've had your completed schedule, you know, firstly, that's excellent. You've got protection on board. And we may find that, for example, we use, you know, Moderna to boost you. Certainly the government has signaled that they've bought Moderna for next year, probably end of this year, early next year, and they're looking to purchase Moderna boosters for those, you know, who might need it. Now, we don't know how we'll boost yet. You know, will we boost based on risk, based on underlying conditions, where you work? All that will come.
Thank you. That was, yeah, it was a really good question, and thank you for explaining that, because I know that I think that's on a lot of people's minds, and primary healthcare providers are, it's challenging for them just to get on top of what the current schedule is, in addition to keeping up all the other routine national immunisation programs. So we really appreciate any support with that sort of information. One of the questions that's come through, Kristine, is around why is COPD under the medically at risk, you know, recommendations, but not funded by the National Immunisation Program for the pneumococcal vaccine to be administered?
Well, I thought it was. I think there is a ability there to have, you know, certainly, you know, some clinician interpretation. So, you know, I think I'd have to pull up the list right now in the handbook listing, but certainly, you know, it's a little tricky, right? Because, I mean, what we're relying on usually is an evidence base of, you know, people with different conditions to say then, you know, there's been a detailed study of it, of pneumococcal, you know, pneumonia or pneumococcal bacteremia or invasive disease in these patients. Now, I think, and I understand, I mean, I'm a, you know, paediatrician infectious disease specialist, so I'm not an expert in lung health like you all are. But, you know, I understand you'll have people who will be on the variation in severity for COPD. And, you know, if there's a milder, you know, form of COPD and the study's been done in that, it hasn't met a threshold. But I think if you see a patient who's got severe lung disease and, you know, they have an impairment in their functioning due to their lung disease, look at that list and just say, well, if this patient is like, you know, other people on the list in terms of their lung function, their capacity, you know, give them that vaccine funded by the NIP. I think that's the way I view this. There's clinician discretion in the clinic at the, you know, to make that call based on the individual patient. You know them best.
Fantastic, thank you. And I will highlight to all our registered participants working, you know, within primary care that the access to those resources are readily available and can act as a very supportive document when it's difficult to determine the recommendations between our medically at risk group and you know, the funding of the vaccines. And we encourage, you know, GPs and nurses to access all those resources available through the NCIRS and the Australian Immunisation Handbook to be able to refer to make that job a lot easier as well. Some questions just come through. Can you give the AstraZeneca second dose after 12 weeks?
You can. So I was just jumping into my list here to look at my chronic respiratory disease. Oh, COPD is on the list. It's on the list. Third dot point down on the handbook. I'll see if I can put the link in a chat. But it is there. So the question was now... sorry, I'm just coming back to you on the screen. The question was... Can I have AstraZeneca vaccine later than 12 weeks? Look, yes, you can. Now, of course, that means you're delaying getting that, you know, more fulsome protection. But if it happened to be 13 or 14 weeks, where we're sitting now in Australia without community transmission, you know, that's no problem. Generally, you don't need to repeat a vaccine if a dose in the schedule is later. There's almost no instance where you need to do that. And in the clinical trials of AstraZeneca, they actually had some people that got the second dose out to as much as 26 weeks. Now, so you know, if you were needing to get it, say, 14, 15 weeks, that's not necessarily a problem. But, of course, we'd like you to get it around that 12-week mark because then we know you've got two doses on board.
Fantastic. And I just wanted to remind the participants as well that under the immunisation resources for health professionals that you've guided us as well, there is a direct link to the Australian Immunisation Handbook, which will guide them through to that table of medically at risk and the recommendations for those vaccines as well. So I've just got one last question which has come through. Will there be a time where we will just have one injection that will cover all vaccines, flu and COVID?
Oh, wouldn't we love that? You know, like just get the, you know, and ideally from birth, and it just covers everything and it gives you 100% protection. Look, I think there's been progress made over years in this. So we now have a 6-in-1 vaccine for babies, for example. And we used to, you know, when I was in the mid-90s, routinely giving vaccines in a clinic that I was working in the United States, I was giving, you know, 4 injections for a period of time, sometimes even 5, because we had new vaccines but they weren't combined. So I think we will move to having more what we call combination vaccines. Don't do that at home yourself. There are occasionally, we hear horror stories of where the GPs mix, you know, not against GPs here, but it tends to be the GP that has mixed, you know, one vaccine in with the other. When that has not been trialled, I mean, the way that you mix vaccines is incredibly, you know, scientifically important, and those trials, though, are done. And there are certain combinations that will come through. Maybe we'll even get a combined flu-COVID vaccine down the track. You know, we don't know. I think what is cool is that the mRNA vaccines are going to open up new possibilities because it's quite a tiny amount of just little mRNA that you can put in there, and we might see that open up a whole new study of combination vaccines to help us, you know, protect more against disease rather than see the you know, very tragic outcomes of it.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Kristine. So I'd like to thank you again for all that comprehensive information and being willing to share your slides. I know that that will be a very beneficial resource for primary healthcare providers. So I just want to thank everybody who joined us live tonight. Please don't hesitate to contact us here at Lung Foundation Australia on 1800 654 301 to learn more about our health professional membership, or you can also visit our website at lungfoundation.com.au. Make sure you also visit our website for a wide range of health professional resources and also, most importantly, management guidelines to support you in your care and management of people living with lung disease and lung cancer. Thank you to all of our primary healthcare teams of GPs and nurses and vaccine service providers who work so hard every day to protect our community by providing immunisation services, and in particular to our most vulnerable people in our community. We know this has been an arduous task in the last 12 months over and above the existing work that GPs and nurses provide. So we thank you from Lung Foundation Australia for putting the effort in, and particularly for our community living with lung disease and lung cancer. Stay safe, take care of yourself and each other, and thank you again for joining us tonight. Good night, and thank you, Kristine.